Well, good morning. I trust that you've had a good week and you're doing all right. I've been calling people and I don't know of anybody out there that's sick that's in our church anyway. And so let's start with a word of prayer and we'll get going this morning. Our Father, we do love you. God, we thank you for your love to us. We thank you for the good day that you've given to us, for the rest that we had last night. And Lord, we thank you for each other. We thank you, God, that we're able to be at home and be healthy and listening to what's going on. And Lord, we pray that you would anoint us with your spirit, that you just bless us and be an encouragement to us today. We do pray for our country, for the pandemic that is taking place in our country. And Lord, for those people that are sick throughout the United States, we pray, God, that you would be an encouragement to them, to their families. We pray, God, that you'd touch and heal them. We pray, Father, for part of people that we are acquainted with that also are feeling poorly and sick. And we thank you that Big Dan Comerford's out of the hospital and doing better. And the doctor says he's got a good slate and can get out in the public on May 1st. And so, Lord, we thank you for touching him and healing him. We prayed for him. We pray for Sue Weiss and Lord, a friend of Linda's, and God, who is still sick, but not with this virus, but God has a lung problem and infection. And Lord, we pray, God, that you would touch her and heal her and that you would restore her strength to her. And we sure praise you for that. We pray, Father, for all of our snowbirds that are down south, and many of them are talking about coming up on their way, some of them. And Lord, we pray that you'd watch over and protect them as they travel and keep them safe. We thank you, Father, too, that they are all strong and healthy. We pray, Father, for our men and women that are in the military, and Lord, that you'd be an encouragement to each of them as they're kind of stuck in places where they're at with a no-travel ban for military. We pray especially for Anthony over in Iraq, that Lord, that you'd continue to keep your watchful hand on him and keep him safe. And pray for Josh in Qatar, and Lord, we pray that for him too, that you'd keep him safe. We pray, Father, that he suffers with the shingles. We pray, Father, that you'd touch that and heal that, and we'll sure praise you for it. We pray now, God, that you'd bless the remainder of the service. We pray for the ladies as they sing, that God, that you'd anoint them and fill them with your spirit. And as we sing along, God, we pray that that our worship might rise to you this morning, a sweet and a fragrant aroma. In Jesus' name, amen.
How great thou art. hearts can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Bowing here, I find my rest, and without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are, and where you are, Lord, holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour.
Ladies, that was wonderful. Great singing today. Anyway, why don't you turn in your Bible with me, if you would, to the 23rd Psalms, chapter 23. I've entitled the message this morning, The Perfections Found in the 23rd Psalm. This is part two. Last week, we looked at the first seven perfections found in the 23rd Psalm. Today, we're going to look at the last seven perfections found in the 23rd Psalm. But before we dive into that 23rd Psalm, I once again was looking around in my devotional book here, and I found a devotional entitled Afraid and Need Courage. Now, that might be you. You may be afraid and need courage today. Maybe it's about this pandemic, but maybe not. I mean, we live in a part of the country where I don't know if there's a whole lot to be afraid of for us, but you may be, but it might be something else. It might be you maybe need to say something to your wife, and you're afraid, and maybe need a little courage to get that to happen. Or maybe, wife, you need to talk to your husband about something, and maybe there's just a little bit of fear there, and you need courage to get that done. Maybe it's kids talking to their parents, and maybe there's a little fear and need a little courage to make that happen. Or maybe it's just something the Lord has said to you. Maybe he said something to you and prodding you to go in a certain direction, and it's fearful to you, and you need some courage. At times, you may be absolutely sure about what you need to do, but you're afraid. At other times, you are confident that God is nudging you to speak certain words or make a specific decision, but you lack the courage to step out in faith. When you sense what God wants you to do, but feel nervous about doing it, know that he will give you the courage you need. As you prayerfully take the first step, you'll experience God's strength. Your heavenly Father, the Almighty God, will give you strength for every situation you face. When you rely on his power, you will be able to run and not be weary. You will be able to persevere and not faint. That is God's promise to you. In Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10, it says this, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And in Psalms chapter 27, verse 14, "Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord." And then in the book of Exodus, chapter 4, verse 11 down through verse 12, "Who gave human beings their mouth? Who makes them deaf or mute? Who gives them sight or makes them blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, and I will help you speak and will teach you what to say." In Romans chapter 8, verse 38 and 39, "I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor heights, nor depths, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Isaiah chapter 40, verse 29 to 31, "God gives power to the weak, and to those who have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary. The young men shall utterly fall, but those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." Isaiah chapter 43, verses 1 down through verse 3. "Thus says the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. And finally, in Psalms chapter 31, verse 24, it says, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart, all you who hope in the Lord. And then in the psalm that's before us, the 23rd psalm, it reads like this. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And then those perfections that are found in the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. That's a perfect salvation. I shall not want. That's perfect satisfaction. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures, a perfect rest. He leadeth me beside the still waters, perfect refreshment. He restoreth my soul. That's a perfect restoration. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake, perfect guidance. I will fear no evil, a perfect protection. Thou art with me, perfect company. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me, a perfect comfort. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies, perfect provision. Thou anointest my head with oil, perfect consecration. My cup runneth over, perfect joy. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, perfect care. And finally, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever, a perfect destiny. Let's have a word of prayer and we'll dive right in. Father, we love you again. We thank you, Father, for your love to us. We pray now, Father, in the quietness of this time, that you'd anoint us with your Spirit, that God, that you'd fill each person, whether they're sitting at home or where they might be this morning. We pray, Father, that you would just anoint them with your Spirit, that you help them to tune in to what is being said. We pray, our Father, that your Spirit would be our teacher, our comforter, the one that comes alongside of us and encourages us. I pray, Father, for myself that you'd anoint me now here in this place and fill me with your Spirit. Give me good recall of things that you and I have looked at. And, Father, I pray that this might flow in the midst of all of this and that, God, that you would be honored. I pray this for your glory and for Jesus' glory. In his name I ask it. Amen and amen. In verse 4, it says, for you are with me. That is a perfect company. Isn't that wonderful that God is with us? He's always with us. It's a perfect company. He never leaves us. Remember a few weeks ago, we looked in Joshua chapter 1, and in verse 9, he said to Joshua, be strong and very courageous. Do not tremble or be dismayed, for I, the Lord your God, am with you. I will not leave you nor forsake you. God is always on your side. He is always with you. He gives you a perfect company. In Deuteronomy chapter 31, in verses 3 and verse 6 and 7 and 8, it says this. In verse 3, it says, Is it the Lord your God who will cross ahead of you? You see, God is ahead of you. He's telling Joshua, that is the Lord that will cross ahead of you. God is a perfect company for us. And he says that not only to Joshua, but he says it to all of us. No matter what it is out there, no matter what kind of a struggle that we're facing, God is out there in front of us. And he says, I will cross ahead of you. He is perfect company. In verse 6, it says, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or tremble at them. For the Lord your God is the one who goes with you. There it is again, that God goes with you. He goes with you no matter what. He will not fail you nor forsake you. He's a sure thing. He is perfect company. In verse 7 it says, then Moses called to Joshua and said to him in the sight of all of Israel, be strong and courageous, for you shall go with this people into the land which the Lord has sworn to their fathers to give to them, and you shall give it to them as an inheritance. And the Lord is the one who goes ahead of you. There he is again. The Lord going ahead of him. He will be with you. All the time God's with you. He will not fail you or forsake you. Do not fear and do not be dismayed. In the Bible, it says that God is a very present help in time of trouble. Very present. So he's there all the time, a present help in time of trouble. In Psalms 121, the whole chapter, verses 1 down through verse 8, it reads like this. It says, I will lift up my eyes to the mountains. From where shall my help come? And then he answers it. My help comes from the Lord, because he is perfect company, who made the heavens and the earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. He who keeps Israel will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. God is not asleep. He is not slumbering. He is perfect company. He's with you all the time. Verse 5 says, the Lord is your keeper. The Lord is the shade on your right hand. The sun will not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will protect you from all evil. He will keep your soul because he's perfect company. He's always there. And the Lord will guard you in guard your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. So the Lord is always there. He's a perfect company, for you are with me, perfect company. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. That's a perfect comfort. In John chapter 14, in verse 16, verse 18, verse 23, and verse 26, it talks about the Spirit of God being our comforter. There in verse 16, in verse 16 it says, and I got Jesus speaking, I will ask the Father, and he will give you a helper, that he may be with you forever. The word helper is referring to the Holy Spirit. It's the word in the Greek language, parakletos. It means one who calls alongside to help, or a comforter, or an advocate, or an intercessor. It's all of those things. So here he talks about the Holy Spirit being a helper, a comforter for us, a perfect comfort. I will ask the Father, and he will give you a helper, that he may be with you forever. He's always there to comfort and encourage and intercede on your behalf. In verse 18, it says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Jesus is always there, and he sends his helper, the Holy Spirit, to come to be a comfort to us. Verse 23, Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our abode with him. He is there. The Father's there. The Spirit of God is there to be your helper, your comforter. And then finally down in verse 26, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I said to you, the helper, the Holy Spirit, to be there to be a comforter, a teacher, a helper, an intercessor, all of that for you, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. That's a perfect provision. In Matthew chapter chapter 6, if you're moving along, Matthew chapter 6, and we're going to look at verses 25 down through verse 33, quite a passage of scripture. Listen to this. It says, for this reason, I say to you, do not be worried about your life as to what you will eat or what you will drink, nor of your body as to what you will put on. Is not your life more than food and your body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, that they do not sow, nor do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not worth much more than they? God is a perfect provision for you. Verse 27, and who of you, being worried, can add a single hour to his life? And why are you worried about clothing? Observe how the lilies of the field grow. They do not toil, nor do they spin. Yet I say to you that not even Solomon in all of his glory was clothed like one of these. But if God so clothed the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is sown in the furnace, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? God is a perfect provision for you. Verse 31, do not worry then, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear for clothing? For the Gentiles eagerly seek all these things, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be added unto you, because he is a perfect provision for us. In John chapter 14, in verse 6, Jesus proclaimed that he was that provision. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by him. Jesus said that he is the way, the only way. He's a perfect provision, the only way to get to God. Not a way amongst a whole bunch of other ways, but absolutely the only way to get to God is Jesus. That's what he's saying. I'm that perfect provision for you. No one can stand before a God that is holy unless he comes by me, unless he comes through me. Jesus is the way. He's a perfect provision. Not only does he say he is the way, but he is the truth. He's not saying that he's a truth amongst a whole bunch of other truths. He's saying he's absolutely the only truth that leads to God. Everything else is false. Everything else is a lie. Jesus is the truth that leads a person to God. He is your perfect provision. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. He's not saying that he is a life amongst a whole bunch of other lives, like a whole bunch of roads leading to God. He is saying, I am absolutely the only life that there is that can get you to God, because he is a perfect provision for us. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, a perfect provision. Then the psalm says, thou anointest my head with oil. That is a perfect consecration. I looked up that word consecration. It means to set apart as holy. That's what consecration means. To set apart as holy. That's the same thing that the word sanctification means. Sanctification means to be set apart. Did you know there are two types of sanctification in the Bible? That's right. There is a sanctification that is an eternal sanctification. The day that you got saved, if you're a Christian, God sanctified you. He set you apart for time and for eternity. He sealed you with his Holy Spirit. His Spirit became the earnest of your salvation. He set you apart for time and for eternity. You are sanctified before God. You have entrance into his presence because of what Jesus did. And when he did that for you and you trusted him, he sanctified you. That's God's part. That's eternal sanctification. That's something that never goes away. But there is also a progressive sanctification. That's your part. That's what you have to do. You, as you get into the word, the Bible says in John chapter 17 and verse 17, Jesus in his high priestly prayer said, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is the truth. So Jesus prayed that we would be in the Word of God, that we would be sanctified, set apart to the Word of God. Why? That we would grow as we learn principles that are in the Word of God, things that God directs us and shows us things we ought to do. He's chipping away at us, forming us into the image of God's Son. So it's our part to get in, to study, and to be obedient to the truth of the Word of God and step out in faith in what God is calling us to do. That's called progressive sanctification. Perfect consecration. Thou anointest my head with oil, perfect consecration. My cup runneth over, perfect joy. You know, when our cup runs over, we have perfect joy. God gives us that perfect joy. It's ours because we're Christians, because we're alive in him. The Bible talks about the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit, note it's singular. It's not a whole bunch of fruits of the Spirit, but it's one fruit. And there's a whole bunch of items in it, but one fruit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. And here comes our word, joy. Peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. So he starts out by saying the fruit of the Spirit is love. To love one another, to love God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our strength. To love our neighbor as ourself. To love people that are around about us. Not just other Christian people, but people that are all around us. We're to love people. That's part of the fruit of the Spirit. And joy. That we would have that joy in heart, and after joy, all of those things fall into place because of that joy. Peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. But it all started with loving God, loving other people, and joy, and then it just starts to build from that. That is the fruit of the Spirit. Where it gives us, our cup runs over, we have a perfect joy. As I was thinking about that, I was thinking about a devotional that I read in a book by Max Lakota. And the book was entitled, When God Whispers Your Name. I wrote that up one time and I put it in the Legion newspaper. And I want to read that to you. It's a great devotion. It starts out by saying, it is quiet. It's early. My coffee is hot. The sky is still black. The world is still asleep. The day is coming. I mean, maybe that's why that attracted me. Because that's the way my day starts every day. I get up early, way up, a lot of times way before you do. I'm sitting here in my office here at the church and it's dark. And I go out in the kitchen and I brew myself up a pot of coffee and I sit down in the dark. It's quiet. It's early. My coffee is hot. The sky is still black. The world is still asleep. The day is coming. In a few moments, the day will arrive. It will roar down the track with the rising of the sun. The stillness of the dawn will be exchanged for the noise of the day. The calm of solitude will be replaced by the pounding pace of the human race. The refuge of the early morning will be invaded by decisions to be made and deadlines to be met. For the next 12 hours, I will be exposed to the day's demands. It is now that I must make choices. Because of Calvary, because of the cross, because of Jesus, I am free to choose. So I choose. I choose love. No occasion justifies hatred. No injustice warrants bitterness. I choose love. Today, I will love God and what God loves. I choose joy. That's our word. I will invite my God to be the God of circumstance. I will refuse the temptation to be cynical, the tool of the lazy thinker. I will refuse to see people as anything less than human beings created by God. I will refuse to see any problem as anything less than an opportunity to see God. I choose peace. I will live forgiven. I will forgive so that I may live. I choose patience. I will overlook the inconveniences of the world. Instead of cursing the one who takes my place, I'll invite him to do so. Rather than complain that the wait is too long, I will thank God for a moment to pray. Instead of clenching my fist at new assignments, I will face them with joy and courage. I choose kindness. I will be kind to the poor, for they are alone. I'll be kind to the rich, for they are afraid. And kind to the unkind, for such is how God treated me. I choose goodness. I will go without a dollar before I take a dishonest one. I will be overlooked before I will boast. I will confess before I will accuse. I choose goodness. I choose faithfulness. Today, I will keep my promises. My debtors will not regret their trust. My associates will not question my word. My wife will not question my love. My children will never fear that their father will not come home. I choose gentleness. Nothing is won by force. I choose to be gentle. If I raise my voice, may it be only in praise to God. If I clench my fist, may it be only in prayer. If I make a demand, may it be only of myself. I choose self-control. I am a spiritual being. After my body is dead, my spirit will soar. I refuse to let what will rot rule what is eternal. I choose self-control. I will be drunk only with joy. I will be impassioned only by my faith. I will be influenced only by God. I will be taught only by Christ. I choose self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. To these I commit my day. If I succeed, I will give thanks. If I fail, I will see his grace. And then, when this day is done, I will place my head on my pillow and rest. My cup runneth over. Perfect joy. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. That's a perfect care. God just takes care of us on every level that I can think of. In the book of Philippians, Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 down through verse 7, it says this. Rejoice in the Lord always. That's what we ought to be, Christian. We're to rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. Let your gentle spirit be known to all men. The Lord is near. Be anxious for nothing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all human comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That sounds like a perfect care to me. Surely, goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, a perfect care, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Isn't that great? We're going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's a perfect destiny. We're not here. We're here. We're pilgrims here. We're passing through this life. This is not our home. We have a home in heaven. Glory to God, we do. Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. Isn't that wonderful? That we have a place that this is not our home, that we're passing through. We have a perfect destiny. We're going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Someday, when we're done in this life, we're going to be ushered by angels in the presence of God. Think of that. And to see Jesus, to have a reunion with people that we know and people that we've never met, people, Bible characters, with Isaiah and Ezekiel and Daniel and Paul and John and Matthew and Mark and all the characters. We get to meet them all. We get to be there and be with them and have fellowship with them. It's going to be so wonderful to be there. We're going to see great things. We're going to be in a place where there's never going to be any death anymore. Never any sorrow, never any pandemics, none of that. It'll all be gone. It'll be perfect, a perfect place where there's no sin. Never going to happen again. We're going to walk past a crystal sea. We're going to see that crystal sea. We're going to see a river of life. We're going to see the tree of life and eat from that tree. We're going to see God high and lifted up. Isn't that a wonderful thought? To think that God is high and lifted up and all the saints, millions and millions of people that have been saved throughout the ages, standing around the throne place of God with their hands lifted up, shouting glory to God, and seeing the angels hovering around his head, crying out, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. That's our destiny. That's our destiny. That's where we're going. And we're going to go over a hilltop and we're going to see Jesus. And he's going to take us to a mansion that he's prepared for us. That is our destiny. The Lord is my shepherd. And here it says, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's our destiny. It's a perfect destiny. In our hymnal, we sing all kinds of songs. There's tons of songs about heaven that we sing all the time. And there's a favorite of mine. It's this one. I can't sing, but I can read it to you. It says, I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, and I am a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the ransomed will shine, that's our destiny. I want a gold one that's silver lined. I've got a mansion. Isn't that great? That's our destiny. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we will never grow old. That's our destiny. And someday yonder, we'll never more wander, but walk the streets that are purest gold. That's our destiny. Don't think me poor or deserted or lonely. I'm not discouraged. I'm heaven bound. I'm just a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a robe, and a crown. I've got a mansion. It's just over the hilltop in that bright land where we will never grow old. And someday yonder, we'll never more wander, but walk the streets that are purest gold. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever, a perfect destiny. What are you going to do with these perfections that are found in the 23rd Psalm? I think God's been working on your heart. I do. I think he's been working on you and pressing you to do things all the time. He's your shepherd. The Lord is your shepherd. You have perfect salvation. That wonder, you've got a perfect salvation. You have a perfect satisfaction in him. You have perfect rest, perfect refreshment, perfect restoration, perfect guidance. He guides you through his word. Perfect protection. He's always there, never leaves you, never forsakes you. Perfect company. He's always beside you, telling you to be strong and courageous, to keep pressing ahead. He's got a perfect comfort. Sends us the Holy Spirit that is our comforter, that's always alongside of us. He gives us a perfect provision. Jesus, what a provision that Jesus has given for all of us. Perfect consecration. He sanctified you, set you apart for time and eternity, and is working on you every day to keep you sanctified, sanctifying you more and more and more that you might be able to become like the image of God's Son. He gives you perfect joy, perfect care, and a perfect destiny. What are you going to do? I think God is calling you to make a decision for him today. Christian, for you to make a decision to do something in that whole thing that God is calling you to do. Won't you make that decision today? And if you're listening and you're lost, won't you make a decision for him? He's that perfect provision for you. Jesus came for you, to die for you, to give his life for you, to bleed on a cross for you, to become your sin on that cross, to die there, to be taken down and put in a tomb and raised, rose again 3 days later. And he says, if you receive him, the Bible says, but as many as receive him, to them he will give the power to become the children of God. Won't you receive Jesus today? Won't you do that? This little poem, the Lord is my shepherd, I never shall want. For lack of his mercies, my soul shall not pant. In pleasant green pastures I daily abide. He leads me, the peaceful still waters beside. My soul he restoreth, and for his name's sake, the path of true righteousness bids me to take. Yea, though I pass through death's dark valley and shade, I will not by evil be ever dismayed. For thou art my shepherd, and with me alway. Thy rod and thy staff are my comfort and stay. My table thou spreadest in the presence of foes. My head thou anointest, my cup overflows. Thy goodness and mercy shall follow me still, while life's earnest duties I daily fulfill, till joyous my spirit shall claim its reward and dwell evermore in the house of the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we do love you. Thank you again, God, for today. Thank you for our study in the 23rd Psalm. I pray now, Father, as people are sitting, listening at their home, that, Lord, that they would do what you've asked them to do, that they would make a commitment to you today, and I'll praise you for it. I pray, God, for any out there that are lost, that today, God, would be a day of salvation for them. In Jesus' name, for his glory and yours, amen and amen.
Sound that saves.